I want to open up the council meeting of Wednesday, May 11th, 2016. Roll call, Councilmember Clayton.
Here.
Councilmember Kendall.
Here.
Deputy Mayor Quinn.
Here.
Mayor Moore.
Here.
Can everybody please rise for a silent prayer, a moment of reflection, please? Flag salute. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. As to comply with the Open Public Meetings Act, Chapter 231, Public Law 1975, adequate notice of this meeting has been provided in the following manner. The annual notice was forwarded to the Asbury Park Press, the Coaster, and the Star Ledger on January 6, 2016, and posted on bulletin board the same date. All notices are on file with the city clerk. We'll move on to matters from city council.
Any matters? Jesse? Number one, thank you, anybody who's wearing pink tonight, and thank Jackie Pappas for reminding us. One quick thing, it was in today, a press release from the city, and it'll be in the Coaster tomorrow, the Sun already has it up. Monmouth County, I quote, Monmouth County Board of Elections has changed the polling districts for District 1 and District 9, moving them out of Lumley to the Mount Carmel Annex. Now, there's a conspiracy theory out there that we did this. I found out about it by getting a letter from the city clerk that the county had changed it, so to put that rumor to bed, we're not trying to disenfranchise anybody. This was a decision made by the county. If anybody has a problem with that, please call the county. That's all I have. Thank you.
Matters by the city manager.
Thank you, Madam Clerk. As per the agreements with iStar, I need two city council members to agree to the proposed parking rates. This does not need to be done by resolution as per the agreements for 2016. What iStar is proposing is to actually have uniform rates across all the parking lots. It would be $8 per weekday, Monday through Thursday in June, increased to $10 per weekday in July, August, $20 a weekend, Friday through Sunday, $20 special event rate, and paid parking would begin this Saturday, weekends only until Memorial Day, then full-time parking, and this will make, as I mentioned, the rates through all the private lots consistent. The agreement stated that the parking committee of the council had to do this. There's two individuals. I believe the committee consists of the deputy mayor and the mayor. Not entirely sure, but to be safe, it's just two people verbally and wanted to get the rates out there publicly. So is there any, the mayor and I spoke earlier, is there any issues with anyone on this? I mean, it's not a resolution, it's just a discussion.
I know you sent an email. I had to, you know, I had my baby all day today, so I didn't read the email. I can absolutely give you a verbal yes as soon as I look at it first thing tomorrow morning.
Okay, that's all that needs to be done. Okay. Thank you. That's all.
Matters by the city attorney?
Nothing at this time.
Can I have a motion to open to the public portion of the council meeting?
So, second.
All in favor? All opposed? The public is expected to conduct themselves in a proper manner. Each member has 3 minutes to speak. When you do come up to the mic, please state your name and address for the record, please.
Can you hear me okay? Okay, thank you. So John Grant, 1205 4th Avenue. I'm here on behalf of the Asbury Park Complete Streets Coalition. And what I want to do is take stock of, you know, where we are today, because the city is doing things. There are people in our group and we're promoting different things. So I wanted to start with the the things that are positive which have happened. So one of the good things is your own complete streets policy, and that's impressive. And not everyone might have read it because it's hard to find on the city's website, but I posted it on Nextdoor for anyone, you know, who can see that. And it's a perfect policy that any city would be proud to have. and then there's been lots of good applications to help the Complete Streets project. I'm going to say we, the city, but we, because it's for the residents, applied for NJDOT pedestrian and bike safety grant. I was at the meeting for the Transit Village designation discussion, and that was very productive. I believe Michelle has applied for that, and if we get that, it leads to sources of other funding that we can get. Yesterday, I did a walkability study as part of the Safe Routes to Schools program that Lisa Lee has organized. So I walked around and looked around Bradley Elementary School at the crosswalks and different things to help that application. Mayor Moore went to the Federal Highway Road Diet training session, and you're to be commended for that because that helps the education of the city council. There's also things that are happening at the federal level. I watched a webinar today by U.S. Transportation Secretary Fox, and he discussed the integral role of transportation plays in connecting people to opportunities. And in regards to the road diet, which is called the NJ Route 71 Pavement Rehabilitation Project, I know you've talked about that you're talking to the DOT, and if you could just give us updates periodically, you know, about what you are discussing, that would be great. And I know that the funding is not jeopardized. You did a conditional endorsement, and I'm assuming that you're talking to them again. And then two questions before my time is up. Do you enforce double parking, especially on Main Street, and what parts of Fourth Avenue will be paved? Thank you.
Michael, what parts of Fourth Avenue will be paved down the road once we do Fourth Avenue? From Ridge to Memorial.
And what about with the grant, though? It's $300,000 from that.
$300,000 is going to be a spit in the bucket, what it's going to cost us, because we're looking at doing major sewer repairs also. It would be no sense that they're either clay or terracotta sewer pipes over 100 years old. Some of them are in bad shape, and we're getting a lot of I&I into the sewer plant when it rains, which we're processing water instead of sewage. So that will correct that. But it's from Memorial to Ridge, and it's going to be well over $1 million.
And may I ask another question about that? Your resolution that you passed to apply for the grant said Ridge to Pine Street. And is that not the case anymore?
No, sir.
Okay.
Okay, and as far as the enforcement of double parking?
We do it as we can get to it. There is an issue, obviously, with the loading zones that there isn't any. Mr. Salerno and myself have had these discussions, and it's very difficult to balance the need of the businesses, because obviously they need to move their goods and wares, versus the safety. That is one of the things that myself and the mayor have spoken to DOT about, is how do we address the loading. Myself and the city planner and the mayor have talked about how do we also revisit the zoning in the area, because that's also part of it. Mm-hmm. It is comprehensive, as you can understand. So to update you on DOT, which we do when we get information. This morning, the project engineer reached out to me about the sewer lines, because we do need to upgrade the Main Street sewer lines. That was 8:30 this morning. I did not hear back from him today. And at 4 o'clock this afternoon, the director of community relations reached out to the mayor. Mayor called him back 5 minutes later and hadn't heard back from him yet. So the statement has been, we need to get the sewer issue fixed, obviously. And what's the status of the traffic counts so that we can move forward with the safety issue. once we get something, we'll announce it, but DOT hasn't given us anything yet.
All right, thank you.
Thank you.
Somebody lower this for a short, guys. That's about good, thank you. Robert Wiener, 601 Madison. I was here Monday night when there was a lot of talk about the problems with the downtown, and I just want to bring up two issues. One is fines, and the second is enforcement. I had heard Belmar got tougher with fines and enforcement, so I went on their website, and it's clearly listed their ordinances. Noise violation, $350. Urinating in public, $350. Alcohol in public, $350. Disorderly conduct, $350. I tried to find out what our fines are. I went to a number of different areas. I finally found somebody in the police department was willing to give me some information, and our fine is $155 for drinking in public. So my thought is, let's get competitive with Belmar. Let's get tougher with our enforcement. And I think enforcement is one of the keys that we're not doing. And I think if we raise our rates, increase our enforcement, I think that bar owners should inform their patrons that this is not a place to be disruptive. It's going to cost you a lot of money. So I think we should look at that, those two issues. I'm trying to simplify it. I know it's not simple. But that's one of the areas I think we have to do, get really tough with the money so people know, don't come here, don't come to Asbury Park and pee in our doorways. That's it. Thank you.
Thank you, and I totally agree with you. And as we discussed Monday, and there's already a social media up on the coaster as far as Monday's meeting, again, the city manager, the deputy police chief are working on this, and there's plans in place, but it's like, we're not going to say the plans in public because it's kind of telling like the bank robber, well, don't rob this bank because we're doing this here. So plans have been put in place already since Monday.
Okay, thank you.
But you're absolutely right. If our fines are totally ridiculously low, that's another avenue we have to look at. So,
Mayor, I want to ask a question to Fred. Under the general fines and fees, we can go up to, I think it's 1950, which is the state law, state maximum. Couldn't the judge also go above the 150, or is it per?
Yes, the judge could go to $2,000 if they wanted.
$2,000 statute, but there may be specific penalties set forth under the criminal code. But that's certainly something that we'll look at and potentially make recommendations for increases to make.
In Belmar, it's an ordinance, and if you get a ticket without having to go to court, that's what you have to pay. If we get a ticket here and you don't have to go to court, it's almost half the price of what Belmar is.
No, that's a great recommendation, Robert.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bess McCarthy. I want to follow up on that a little bit because Saturday morning, you know, they probably brought it up Monday, but you come into your stores, throw up all in your doorway, all the way down the block, and planners thrown over, garbage cans thrown over with their beer cups on there, beer cans, garbage bags from I don't know where. But anyway, the problem really is you have five policemen on for the night shift for the whole town. You have drinking on the beachfront, you have downtown, you have Main Street, you have the west side. You have five policemen. Even if you're going to give them fines, they're not there to get them. That's why it's all happening. So I talked to some other people, and I think all the bars should chip in, since it's their disorderly customers, and let them pay to have policemen down there at night when the bars get out, and let them pay for them instead of the taxpayers and the residents and everybody paying for, you know, their businesses causing problems. And I just want to know, you know, like what, so you're saying you're doing something about it or not, the police?
Mm-hmm. Are you done, Bess?
Yeah.
And just so everybody knows, and we go back many years, and Bess called me on Sunday quite upset, and I didn't call you back, but I got in touch with the city manager immediately, who got in touch with the police chief immediately and asked to send a police officer to your business, and I was told they were already there addressing the problem with you. There is no excuse except we're going to be doing a better job. Michael's going to answer, but there was a lot more than five police officers on Saturday night.
It was Friday night. On Friday night, 12 on Saturday night, and four specials in addition to that, which clearly isn't enough. I mean, that there's no question
about
that.
They said they only had have five on at night.
That's not according to the report I got.
That's the scheduled maybe shift, but we know there's a problem out there, so we've put on additional. Let Michael finish. Go ahead.
I don't want to get into the shift of the police department, because there obviously is, as the mayor said, about, you know, telling the bank robber issue. I don't want to get into that. But one of the things that we discussed, that was discussed on Monday about making the businesses pay, and the mayor had mentioned that years ago there was the possibility of a special improvement district, which the businesses would then be able to allocate resources. Tuesday morning, I emailed Ms. Pappas and our director of communication of let's sit down and figure out a way sometime next week, because I'll give a plug to Jackie, it's the Carousel Awards this week, and she's pretty busy with that. That we'll sit down next week and find a way to reach out to the businesses to see if there is an interest.
What businesses?
The businesses in the Central Business District.
No, I don't think we should be paying for nighttime people that are doing damage to our businesses. Is that what you're talking about? For us to pay for police?
It's a possibility. And
no.
That's part of what the survey would be.
You already raised my taxes 100%. The last time, almost 10 grand in one shot. I'm not paying more money for all this liquor, all these bars you keep increasing, drinking, got all these kids down here. You don't even care about kids, just fill them up with liquor. I mean, really, it's ridiculous. Bar crawls, kids walking around drinking all day. Then they wonder why they get in trouble. They should be ashamed of themselves, people.
Thank you, Bess. Next.
Ed Baumgarten, 704 4th Avenue. I'd like to read a statement to the council. That is that Asbury Park has a drug problem. The neighbors next to a house I own on Sunset Avenue have been dealing drugs for years, and it's only been getting worse and worse. Calling the police has resulted in no improvement. Meeting with the police has resulted in no improvement. Chief Salerno has known about the situation for over 2 years, and there's been no improvement. I've spoken with Lieutenant Desain and Sergeant Warwick reporting the activity, and there's been no improvement. The drug activity is constant, day and night. I have had one family that I rented my house to who moved out within 6 weeks due to the noise and safety issues. My second tenant is currently moving out after only 2 weeks because of the noise and safety issues. The collateral effects of the drug trafficking are no small matter either. My tenant reports, and I quote, "The reality is that there's an enormous amount of traffic up and down the driveway all night long, perpetually idling cars in the street and partying loud music in the driveway all the time. My 11-month-old baby has woken up almost on a nightly basis. This is a baby that previously slept uninterrupted for 13 hours a night in Brooklyn, with neighbors living above and to the left and right. There are often cars sitting in the driveway, blasting music at all hours while people get super drunk. People are up and down the driveway minute to minute all night long," unquote. I've since learned that my tenants have been harassed by panhandling. There have been fights with guns involved. People sleep in the garage and relieve themselves in the side yard. The noise and public disturbance is constant. The address is a known hangout and drug den by the police. And all of this is across the street from the high school in a drug-free zone. Our police department often speaks about needing community involvement and being made aware of illegal activities. Yet when I've called to report illegal activity, the response has been minimal to none. At best, a squad car is sent, and they tell the offenders to, quote, quiet down. However, to my knowledge, no investigative work has been done, no summons issued, no arrests made, no follow-ups to complaints have been made, are done. In other words, the police tolerate and implicitly condone these illegal activities, even with help from us citizens. When reporting drug activity, I was even asked by one of the AP sergeants, what exactly do you want the police to do about it? Detective Lieutenant Desain just informed me 4 days ago that some action is finally being taken because I've been a squeaky wheel. But until our police department takes proactive steps and no longer tolerates the drug dealing and quality of life issues, the criminal element will remain in force, and Asbury Park will remain one of New Jersey's failed cities. Statement to the council, please. Thank you.
Thank you. I apologize. If you give your contact information to the city manager, somebody will be in touch with you tomorrow with an update.
Thank you, Mayor.
Thank you.
And the address of the problematic. Can you give your address and the
you don't want to stay all night, we'll take a little break, come up, give it to Michael now, so you can go home. Okay.
No, I'm
okay.
Or you can stay the whole meeting.
Totally up to you.
Hi, Danny Weiss, 1205 Fourth Avenue. My husband made this really high. Thanks, John. So, following up on those remarks that you just made, I'd like to talk about something that may or may not be on your radar, and that is what's popping up all around the city are these tents. And we've all seen them. They're different colors. They're yellow, they're white, they're off-white, and they're very large. They're almost like portable garages. And so they're popping up. I'm not gonna name any addresses, but apparently after contacting code and zoning here, there's nothing prohibiting them. And that's what I was told. Like, nope, you know, there's nothing on the books. And so the concern I have with these are numerous, and they're concerns that our city administration and our council should have. And I'll name just a couple that come to my mind. And I typed these away before. So tents becoming permanent structures in backyards as opposed to maybe being set up for something temporary, like a party or a wedding or something that should be a day or perhaps a weekend, but instead becoming permanent. What's being stored in these structures? Could it be something combustible? What's being serviced in these structures? Is it something, for example, like a car being maintained where oil or gas or other contaminants could be spilling? Are these de facto garages and becoming permanent structures? Do they act as venues for illegal activity? We all hear and know about lighting and cameras and keeping bushes and trees clear of areas so police can monitor and see things. But if you have these structures that are placed up permanently, nobody can see inside what's going on inside. It's not a house, it's just a tent, which invites criminal activity. They could be places for people to sleep, whether with or without the consent or even knowledge of an owner or a renter who may have erected these tents. They're also incredibly unsightly. They could be dangerous. They can blow away in a storm and cause personal injury or property damage to neighbors. This is something that, thank God, has a remedy, and it's easy. And you can do it, and you can enact ordinances. And I really urge and beg this council to take this up because they're popping up. They become popular. It could also be something maybe seasonal that they're going up now and just staying up, and they've got flaps all around them so you can't see anything inside. But they're also just becoming more popular over the past few months. And I'm sure I haven't even articulated all the concerns that people should have, not the least of which is drug activity and drinking and everything else. So thank you very much for listening to my concerns. I appreciate it.
No, thank you, and I've seen a couple. I didn't know it was that bad, but a couple is probably too many. And if we don't have anything on the books, I strongly agree. And we're finding out more and more every week. I mean, we announced Monday, we thought we had something on the book saying if your burglar alarm goes off and there's 15 calls a year, you pay a fine. We're the only town in Monmouth County that doesn't have that. So we're finding out there's a lot of things on the books that should be on the books. This is one that should be on the books. So
and this is something that
know what's on and how we can put something on, be it an ordinance, as quick as possible.
I'll be honest, Danny, I don't even know what you're talking about. So maybe
what I'd love to do is email you pictures
sure.
about these. I mean, truly, I don't want to get people in trouble because I was informed by code and zoning that there's no ordinances against them. So I can't report something that's not an infraction.
Just because it's code and zoning doesn't mean fire.
That's a good point.
Two of the three, but Kevin and I are talking now that there is fire aspect. So
absolutely, you're absolutely right.
So if when you send them to the deputy mayor, send them to myself and Kevin. And
thank you.
We need the addresses.
Okay. Thank you so much. I appreciate it.
Thank you, Dan.
Good evening. My name is Gil Olson. I'm from Summertime Surf and from Point Pleasant. Our office is in Belmar. But we've been in Asbury for This is coming into our sixth year of operations, and we're just here for the resolution to pass renewing our lease. And we just want to thank everybody in the city, the community, for all the support in the past couple years. And everybody in the city offices has been super helpful. Mr. Raffetto, Cindy Dye, and everybody that we've been in contact with has been helpful to get it all set up so we can have another awesome summer. When we came into town and kind of got formally established, we were really excited about partnering with the local community to get kids on scholarship, and we're happy to report, not that we make it to all the council meetings, but we've gotten a lot of support from community partners, and iStar has been a huge help in sponsoring the Boys and Girls Club kids, and we've got an awesome coordination going with Doug, getting the kids down for multiple weeks in the summer. And we're just excited to keep doing that, as well as some of the kids from the rec department as well through Asbury. So we just want to thank you guys for all your support, and we're looking forward to many more awesome summers to come.
Great. Great job.
Thank you.
And we thank you for all your volunteer work and all the free services you give to Asbury Park residents, especially the children. So thank you.
Thank you. Hey, good evening. Warner Baumgartner, Fifth Avenue. I noticed on the agenda today that you are considering a resolution to allow an encroachment onto public space. As you know, as a city historian, I have testified about this topic numerous times in the past, and I think I need to again remind you that being council has a large burden of being stewards of public property, and encroachments on public property by default are not something that is desirable. In reading this particular application, I see certain things here that caught my attention. Number one, it says that the council determined that this appears to have no detriment to the public good. Well, an encroachment by its very definition is a detriment to the public good. It's privatization of public property. Giving over public property to private use is something that should be avoided at all opportunity. Also, there's some language in here that tries to set forth that this is good because the neighbor has an encroachment. You know, there's no evidence that the neighbor's encroachment is in fact illegal or legal. So, allowing something to follow suit that a neighbor did is certainly not logical. To come before you and say, oh, I'd like to do an encroachment onto public property because my neighbor has an encroachment, is a logical fallacy. There's no proof that the existing encroachment next door was permitted at any point in time. This is purely for aesthetic reasons, from what I could tell. Encroachments should be for a specific technical hardship, such as a handicapped ramp, or an erosion issue that can't be mitigated any other way. What it does is it takes public property out of the public realm. Green space, Asbury Park, is very dependent on its view corridors, on all its avenues. And to divvy up these view corridors with various encroachments is a detriment to the city landscape. Also, there's a technical error in this, which you should be aware of. It says that this is being allowed in accordance with the application that's made and the representations. Well, the representation is that this wall is going to be 100 feet by 300 feet by 100 feet. This is technically beyond the scope of this person's property lines. So aside from the philosophical issues of giving away an encroachment permit on city property that doesn't belong to the private property owner, I would recommend that you don't do this. Also, the technical aspects are incorrect. The measurements are completely wrong and don't describe the actual dimensions of what this will be. I'm going to suggest that you table this until you look at this a little closer. Thank you very much.
Thank you. The measurements do concern me, so I don't know.
Excuse me. May I follow up?
No. No. You'll get your turn.
Thank you, sir.
But I don't know if you looked at the pictures.
Yes.
Okay,
yes.
To me, there is an erosion problem there. And if you, okay,
yeah.
This is just so, nobody knows, this is not, everybody knows, this is not an 8-foot fence. Yeah. This is like three pavers in the front yard to stop. stop the erosion, because the guy kind of has like a property like me on a hill, where this 3-block paver, which is way off the sidewalk, will stop that erosion problem.
Mr. Mayor, as you know, most properties are elevated from grade, and they have either a lawn or a retaining wall, but the retaining wall can certainly be on the person's property. There's no reason to take public property when there's ample room on the person's private property to mitigate anything that needs to be dealt with.
And I think it's written into this proposal that if the city ever needs that property, it's understood that that wall comes down in a heartbeat.
You know what? Once something is built, it's highly unlikely it's ever removed, and it becomes a challenge to remove encroachments, as has been demonstrated in the past around the city. You know, it's incremental. It's like a cancer. You know, giving encroachments on public rights of way, incrementally, onesie, twosies, threesies doesn't seem like much.
Okay, well, you know? Made your point. You
yeah.
Questions.
When you add them up, it becomes a real problem.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, Ryan Kutu, 704 7th Avenue. I'm here representing Asbury Park Ventures, the owner of the subject property for the retaining wall. I just want to clarify a few things. Mr. Baumgartner, I'm sorry. Perhaps you misread. The measurements on the application say 300 inches by 100 inches. That's an inch symbol, not foot marks, so it's much smaller than you said. I agree that it would be an extremely large benefit for the city. The property is about 50 yards from the intersection of Main Street and Asbury Avenue, and when heavy rains come, there's a lot of pooling in that area and extreme flooding, as you know, with the ever-increasing sewer problems, and this is just one way that I could help to mitigate that at my own expense. There's a lot of water that runs from this property into Asbury Avenue and over to Main Street. I'd like to add that it would be a great aesthetic benefit because it's a part of what has now become a block-wide project on the 700 block of Asbury Avenue, improving all of the front landscaped areas, creating some much more pleasing landscapes. Also, you suggested that I would request this just because the neighbor has it. The neighbor does have lots of proof on record with the city. The permits were granted in 2005, I believe. I would have to just double check that because I don't have the documents with me. But there seems to be an error when that permit was granted, and the wall, actually, if you look at the survey, the wall that she erected actually continues 6 feet past the property line into my property. So I'm only requesting there's a small walkway where it stops. I'm requesting to to mimic the wall an additional 300 inches along the front. So it's already on about 25% of the property. I'm just asking to complete it along the front line. Again, I think this would be great, Mayor Moore, like you said, to reduce the erosion. It would also help to mitigate the stormwater runoff that contributes to the flooding sewer systems. And it would be a great aesthetic improvement to Asbury Avenue. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, T. Lisinski, 3rd Avenue. I'm here for two reasons. I want to address the ever-growing traffic issue on 3rd Avenue where I am, and I know that's in 4th, and well, you know, John, and it's all the streets we have around here. And I was wondering, I'm glad you're doing the complete streets, but I'm wondering what in the near future, like tomorrow or next week, can you start doing something about the traffic, whether it be temporary speed bumps or signs or something that would slow the traffic down, because it's really bad and the noise levels are above what they really should be. And the second question I have is the algae treatment for Wesley Lake. I'd like a status on that for the contribution for the city, if you would, between the two. Thank you.
Okay, Michael, have you been in touch with Vito?
Yeah, we played phone tag for a little while.
Okay, because just so you know, Congress in 2008 has recognized that algae is harmful to water bodies, and it's something that is excused from a lot of the bidding practices. And I know, for example, Washington, Ohio, they have given loans with a forgiveness of principal payback from the Congress or from their state. So things like that are permitted. And I don't know if any of you have asked about that aspect of treating the lake and any water body in town to help you pay for the, you know, the cost of the algae treatment. Because the citizens of Wesley Lake has blown their $30,000 for aerators and algae treatment through the last couple years, and we can't do it anymore. So we got to somehow be creative and find funding for it.
Has the algae treatment done anything for Wesley Lake?
Well, last year...
Every year we're asked to pay that. Algae treatment.
No,
every year it doesn't.
No, you have... Only last year you were asked to pay for algae.
No,
we paid for it last year. You did not pay.
Let me say this. I've been on the council for 2 years, and for 2 years we've been...
You contribute $500, but that's just for operate. That's for, like... minimal expenses. The citizens of Wesley Lake paid for all the algae treatments last year and the year before and the aerators.
Okay.
Last few years. So.
Well, okay.
I'm not arguing with you. I'm just.
If we paid or didn't pay, I believe we paid too, because Dr. Brantley came here and made, when Myra Campbell was mayor.
I asked Ricky, the CFO. We never received anything from last year.
Okay.
That was part of the issue facing this year's $5,500 request. Was last year was never in the budget because we never were requested to pay, and that's been one of the things that I've said to the Dr. Brantley when we saw him at Speaker Prieto's event, is we didn't have the money in the temporary budget for this because no one ever told us this. We found out after the temporary budget was done, and involving the bidding and procurement, under New Jersey law, we have to bid certain amounts, and so that's what my conversation with Vito has to be, is how is this procured, because we have to do certain things, and that the city doesn't have an issue paying for it. We just don't have the money now in our temporary budget, and how do we figure out to pay for it in September, October, when our budget's passed?
That's why I said exceptions may be applied if it's an emergency to do the application for the lake. I don't know if you can call Commissioner Richmond of DCA and ask for, or whoever monitors the city, but if you could find out or just ask the question, because maybe we can get this resolved, because if it's not treated now, we're not going to, the business on Wesley Lake of the swan boats are going to be shot, because we're not going to be able to control it.
What we're saying is we're willing to pay it. We have to do it the right way. We're not going to be able to pay it till August, so Neptune may have to front the money and we'll pay them back.
Okay, but if you reach out to the state, maybe they can help.
Well, okay, and
I mean,
if Vito,
give it a shot.
I wish
I knew this before, but I didn't know what was going on.
Okay.
I would have mentioned this a long, long time ago.
No problem, T.
I know.
All the hard work you put in.
Because I appreciate everything you guys have done.
We appreciate everybody on the committee. So, yes, we're willing to pay. Like Michael said, we're different than Neptune. We're a state-owned entity.
Oh, I know.
An MOU. We cannot spend a penny. So we have to do it the correct way, or else we're going to lose that twice over in state aid. So we're willing to pay it. It's just that it wasn't in the budget.
Mm-hmm.
We may not be able to pay it to August, September when we adopt a budget, and then we can move money around. And so we'll work out, Michael and Vito will work something out where it will be done.
Okay.
And it will be paid.
Okay, great. I appreciate it.
Okay, thank you.
All right. And about the traffic?
The traffic?
Well, part of that is because of Sunset being closed, but I'll ask the police department to put the speed trailer up so we can get some data and look at, you know, speeds and car volumes in the next...
Okay, all right. It did start before the bridge was closed. It's been bad for years over there. I know, for many years, for many, many years. But it's just increasing with the redevelopment, and without a traffic plan or traffic study for the rest of the town, traffic is not flowed in evenly directions and dispersed. So, and the roads don't handle it well. So, and the speeding has to be monitored, because the noise levels are way above, other than the safety of it. People don't go 25. I'd go 25. People are disturbed going 25, a lot of people, and they go, the average limit is 35 to 45 with 50 on 25. So that's why I'm just want to know when something's going to be done. Because I've been there 2 years in July, and 30 years on 7th Avenue, which we didn't have too much of a problem because it's not a thoroughfare, you know, because nobody likes to make a left-hand turn on the end of 7th.
I know this is going to come down for Rita. Good evening, Mayor and Council. First of all, thank you so much for participating in the Paint the Town Pink program, of all of us wearing pink today. For those of you who don't know why there are lots of people wearing pink today, it is to raise awareness for getting an annual mammogram. So I also just wanted to thank all of the businesses that there are many of them in the city that are participating in one way or another, but specifically the Chamber sponsored a contest and exhibit, which is going to be standing until the end of May, and we have several businesses that participated in what we called Bravo. So they have a display in their window, so please do go by and see it because they worked very hard on some of these. So I'd just like to thank the businesses involved at the table, Oasis Home, Backward Glances, Purple Glaze, Nita Ideas, and Langosta Lounge up at the boardwalk. And this year was a really difficult decision because they all really put in great effort. But the winner this year is Backward Glances. So I hope that you will all go by and see these great displays. And you still have time to pink up your business, so please do so. Thank you.
Thank you. Next.
Hi, Rita Moreno, 8th Avenue. On the agenda, there's the Turf Lounge property. Does the city own that?
It's been tabled.
What?
It's been tabled.
Oh, it's been tabled. Okay. The other thing I want, Monday night, you read off the resolutions, but sitting in the audience, we don't know, you're discussing the resolutions amongst yourselves. Now, there's all these people here tonight, and what you're going to do is vote on them, and nobody knows what they are, including me, who was here Monday night. You discussed a few things about them amongst yourselves, but nobody really knows what they are until you come here and you get all this. This should be here on Monday night, all this. This is a lot of work that Cindy did or whoever did it, but on Monday night, if you had this in front of you, you know what you're talking about. And the other thing, did you go out to bid for the jazz festival?
No. Next. No.
You didn't go out to
no,
bid?
No.
Why not?
Because we put it out 6 times on an RFP, and we got tired of wasting taxpayers' money because nobody responded. So, no.
And also, Rita, just so you know, that packet goes up on the website when it's delivered to us.
I can't read it on the website.
Okay.
It's so much to read.
I agree.
I guess my point is, I'm sure Cindy would make you a copy if you needed a copy, but it is up on the website the week prior to the council meeting.
I know, but if this was here on Monday night, it would be a lot better.
Okay.
But first of all, on Monday night, there was only 10 or 12 people here. Now, tonight you have a full house, and you're going to vote on these things. And you want transparency, right? That's what you talk about.
So from now on, I agree with you. They'll be up out there on Mondays.
Thank you.
No, I agree.
And getting back to the jazz festival, did I see that Charity King? Is that the name of that organization that's going to do it?
Finish all your questions, and I'll respond.
What?
Finish all of your questions, and I'll respond. Or else you're going to say, John, you took some of my 3 minutes.
Okay. And the other thing, it's only a rumor. You know how rumors go around.
In Asbury?
Yeah. that on Memorial Drive, the old Fisher Baking Company is up for sale.
Finish all your questions.
And that the city was going to buy it? That's impossible, I think.
Finish all your questions.
Huh?
Finish all your questions.
That's it.
Okay. Can you repeat them? I forgot them. As far as what was presented Monday night, and I thought Alicia made it clear as far as the jazz festival, that is not the city's 26th annual jazz festival. That is something that the Charity Kings applied to put on, called a jazz festival. They applied for 2016. They applied for a date. The city said, come in and tell us what you're going to do. They didn't know what they were going to do, so they canceled it. And they put in a holder for July 1st of 2017. That's all they did, holding a date for 2017. So as far as the Old Fish's Bakery, the Braverman Building, 4th and Memorial, it's been owned for probably 10 years by the state of New Jersey, the school division. They bought it years ago, trying to give it to the Board of Education to be an early learning center. The Board of Education unfortunately didn't take advantage of it. The state's been sitting on it, tax exempt, for many years. We asked the state to give it to the city, not a penny. The state said no, so they're putting it out for public auction. The city was thinking about bidding on it, but realistically, realistically, I think opening bid's 10,000.
What?
If we bid 10,000, we're hoping nobody else is going to bid, but we won't even throw in a bid because we know people are going to be bidding a lot of money on it. But yes, it's June the 6th or June 2nd by the state of New Jersey, Division of Schools, public bid, open to anybody. There's signs up all over the place. Personally, I'm hoping somebody buys it and puts it back on the tax rolls.
Okay.
Nope, your time's up.
That sounds good.
Okay. Thank you. Happy belated birthday.
Good evening. My name is Frank Brogna. I'm the commander of the Veterans of Foreign Wars, Harold Daly Post 1333, 701 Lake Avenue. Also a veteran of Operation Iraqi Freedom and joined by my friend and past post commander Lou Parisi, World War II veteran. I'd like to read a statement regarding Memorial Day activities hosted by our Veterans of Foreign Wars post, written by Mr. Parisi. Mayor Moore, Deputy Mayor Quinn, City Council members Clayton and Kendall, City Manager Capobianco, Police Chief, Acting Police Chief Anthony Solano, and Fire Chief Ketty, Administration, Veterans, and the citizens of Asbury Park. With each passing year, we're saddened to see the list of our honored fallen who have given their lives to safeguard our liberties here at home grow larger. It is all the more reason for us to acknowledge the debt owed them by a public ceremony on Memorial Day, the day on which our nation calls on all Americans to pay tribute to their sacrifice. We in Asbury Park are fortunate to have a memorial park that is centrally located with an open area bordering Sunset Lake. Here, under a towering old glory before an eternal flame monument, we can all assemble for this sacred day of remembrance. Our veterans, VFW Post 1333, Catholic War Veterans Post 714, Jewish War Veterans Post 125, the Disabled American Veterans, the Tuskegee Airmen Association, the Auxiliaries, along with our comrades of other veterans posts, would be honored by your presence again this year for our annual Memorial Day service on Monday, May 30th. At 9 a.m., our Asbury Park firefighters will hold their traditional service at Fireman's Park Memorial Park on Main Street between Sunset and Fifth Avenues. At 10 a.m., we will gather at Veterans Memorial Park on Fifth Avenue, two blocks east of Main Street. As is customary, we will pay honor to all those brave men and women who have made the supreme sacrifice for the freedoms we enjoy today. At this same service, the Asbury Park Policemen's Benevolent Association will pay homage to two of their own who lost their lives in the line of duty. Your presence at these services, together with firefighters, policemen, our veterans, and fellow citizens, will serve as a fitting reminder of all the debt all Americans owe in honoring our fallen heroes, authored by our very own World War II veteran, Lou Parisi. Please join us on May 30th for Memorial Day ceremony to honor our fallen. Thank you.
Thank you. Lou, would you like to say something, Lou?
If I may.
You're one of the few people that the time goes off on.
Lou Parisi, Veterans of Foreign Wars, Asbury Park. We are the dead. Short days ago, we lived, felt dawn, saw sunset glow, loved and were loved, and now we lie in Flanders Fields. Many of you are too young to remember that that was the best known and most cherished war poem of all time. It was written during World War I. That was the war you remember, the Great War, the war that was billed as the war to end all wars. We lost 116,000 men in France. If they were the only men that we were to honor on this Memorial Day, it would still be our duty to be there. But do you realize that in the past 75 years, each generation has suffered even greater losses? World War II, 406,000. Korea, 36,000. Vietnam, 58,000. The two Gulf Wars, Afghanistan, and now the wars against terrorism abroad and at home, another 10,000. Over 500,000 Americans gave their lives. On Memorial Day, they made the supreme sacrifice. They asked for an hour of our time to honor those brave heroes, our firemen, and our policemen. Let us all join together to pay them tribute and to ask a merciful Lord to grant them everlasting peace. Thank you.
Jerry, just one second. Let me say something, and I know Lou's going to yell at me later, because Lou and both Frank are the type of guys that, like, don't acknowledge us, and it's wrong. Lou, throughout the years, has done a great job. Frank is doing a great job. Everybody at Post 1333 does a great job. People don't know what they do. They were a major sponsor at the Rodeo for Recreation. They're always going up and above and making charitable contributions to many, many great causes in Asbury Park. I cannot thank you two enough and the entire 1333 for all you do for Asbury Park and the surrounding area. So thank you so very, very much. And everybody knows John hates making speeches, and Lou makes me. He said, John, you're getting your ass up here and you're making a speech on Memorial Day. And I love it because my father was one of the greatest generation, and it means a lot to me on that day. It means a lot to people like the Vaccaros. It means a lot to everybody. It means Jimmy Desposito, a great friend of all of ours who passed away, Chippy Coleman. It is a great ceremony with great people. And years ago, we were losing 400 vets from World War II a day. That was from the museum in New Orleans. With everybody getting older, it's more than 400 a day, and they were the greatest generation. And I can never thank you guys enough, so thank you. Jerry?
Hello, Mayor and Council, Jerry Scrano, Long Branch. I'd like to ask a couple questions or suggestion on what on the first part is, Elizabeth now joined Newark about Hoover picking up people at the train station and at the airport. And on the news, they were saying that the taxi and limousine service pay a lot of insurance and pay a lot of money for the right to be our, to deliver people around. And I think we need to follow step or follow those cities on what they're doing, because it's not fair for the taxi cab people that live in town, pay taxes, shop in our stores, so someone from Ocean Township or Wall Township can go make $40 or $100 on the weekend. So you have to fix that for the residents. The other thing is, I'd like to know what the Fisher Baker building is zoned for, because I believe before the state gives the property away or sells it for whatever, we should know who's gonna buy it, what they intend to do with it, and how the city's gonna benefit. And we should have the final say on who gets the building, because the state, what's $100,000 to them? But if we don't get the right company in there, I always wanted a transit village to go up Memorial, and I wouldn't mind an office building going up there with no taxes or with a tax abatement if they were guaranteed to hire 30 or 40% of the employees from the town. We really have to have a say on where that building's going, and we really got to prevent a non-profit taking over that building, because that's a commercial zone, and we should get top dollar for that. And then the other thing is, because I only have a minute left, is we need a budget committee, because other towns in the area can have no tax increase, zero tax increase, or something even less, you know, where they have a positive cash flow. We're doing something wrong here. And I know you guys try your best, but like we say, you always got to push a little harder to make things happen. So could you tell me what the Fisher Price Bakery is zoned for, how we can have an influence on the buyer? Maybe the Chambers of Commerce could send out flyers, I mean emails, blast to other towns or corporations, but there has to be a way to bring something better than what could possibly go there. I mean, there's a lot of things that could go bad. And then the other thing I wanted to say is, I forgot, why are we giving land away to nonprofits? Why can't the nonprofits buy foreclosures and keep them out of the hands of slumlords and out-of-towners? Why can't they become resident home for residents, affordable housing? You gotta fix this. It's really sad when homes are being sold for $40,000 to someone out of town so they can rent them for $1,400 a month. Okay, thank you.
Okay. Because...
No answers?
No, I know. But you asked what it was zoned for, then you told me it was zoned commercial. So is it or is it? You answered your own question. Michelle, what's it zoned for? Just yell it.
No, I just want to verify. I believe it's a split zone. Part of it's in the B2, part of it is in the LI, in the light industrial.
Tell everybody what B2 and LI is, because I don't know.
Okay, light industrial zone.
I'm a realtor and I don't know what you just said.
Okay, well, she's going to repeat it and make it so we can all understand.
The B2 is the secondary business district, meaning that you can do retail, you can do service, you could do office. And you also can have a limited number of residential units on the second floor. The light industrial is that you could do light industrial, which includes light manufacturing and warehousing.
Okay.
I think, you know, if you want more information.
No, I'm just in general, because I just hate to see a nonprofit go there like some of the other worthy organizations in town. I'll leave it blank.
We will pass.
Thanks, Michelle.
We will, I agree with you. I don't know, I don't believe the state put any stipulations on it.
They can't.
They can't. We will pass it along to the legislators. As far as, I read the article in the papers about Uber, and I think that, and I sent them so we can look into them. The reason NORC could do it, because they own an airport. We don't own an airport. So
but Elizabeth said their train station. That was on the news today.
Okay, so we're looking into that. And as far as like what land did we give away to nonprofits?
No, I mean
for no money.
When we have nonprofits asking you for land so they can put up houses,
but they're asking for land. But maybe in the past they got it for zero. But with this council, nobody's.
Well, I was under the impression that may be happening sooner than I thought.
No,
okay.
Sir, no.
But we should be encouraging them to buy the foreclosures for $40,000 instead of out-of-towners. Okay, and then the budget committee, I mean, other towns are crowing that no tax increase.
Well, and Jerry, you know, because you come to every meeting, and you know that we're on transitional aid, and as long as the state's giving us $1.5 million, they enforce us to raise the taxes.
Just because I have free gas doesn't mean I drive around town looking for other people to pick up for free rides. Okay, thank you very much. I appreciate your help.
Okay, thank you. Anybody else? Motion to close.
Move it.
Second. All right, we're going to move on to the consent agendas. All a matter listed on a consent agenda are presented collectively to the City Council and will be considered for approval with one vote. These matters are considered to be routine in nature, and there will be no individual discussion on these items. If discussions are desired on one or more council members as to a particular item, then said item shall be removed from the consent agenda separately. We have only six resolutions this evening. 2016-18, approving special events, wedding applications as presented on May 9, 2016. 2016-19 resolution authorizing the payment of payroll in an amount of $885,583.11. 2020, resolution to credit sewer account for 1523 Summerfield Avenue. 2016-221 resolution authorizing transfer of title for surplus vehicle to the borough of Allenhurst. 2016-222, resolution authorizing compensation payment to Anthony Nuccio upon his retirement. And 2016-223, resolution authorizing compensation payment to Jason LaRusso upon his separation of employment. Did any council member like to remove any of these items from the consent agenda? If not, can I have a motion to approve, please?
Move it.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn stepped out, and Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Individual resolutions. Resolution 2016-224, resolution authorizing a payment of bills in the amount of $3,201,797.90. Any, can I have a motion to approve this resolution?
Move it. Second.
Comments or questions? Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Resolution 2016-225, resolution identifying menu items per subsequent developers agreement between the City of Asbury Park, Madison, Asbury Retail, LLC, and Asbury Partners. Can I have a motion to move this resolution, please?
Move it.
Second.
Comments or questions? Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Resolution 2016-226, resolution amending the temporary appropriations for 2016. Can I have a motion, please?
Move it.
Second.
Comments or questions? Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Resolution 2016-227, resolution authorizing and or ratifying change order number one to the contract with T&M Associates for professional design, bidding, and construction administration services for the wastewater treatment plant roof repair. Can I have a motion, please?
Move it.
Second.
Comments or questions? Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Resolution 2016-228, resolution of the Mayor and Council of the City of Asbury Park referring proposed amendments to the Central Business District Redevelopment Plan to the City of Asbury Park Planning Board and directing the Planning Board to take certain actions pursuant to NJSA 48:12A-7E. Can I have a motion, please?
Move it.
Second.
Comments or questions?
Yeah, I have a question. I probably should have done this earlier and I forgot. This is to correct the problem where we had downtown with the sound mitigation to make it easier so music is alive in Asbury Park. And we asked the Planning Board if they could put this on their next week's agenda, and they said no. So can we ask the Planning Board if they can have a special meeting? Just, we want to move this process as quick as possible so people can play music and correct a problem we inherited. So I want to do it as soon as possible.
I think if we amend the resolution, because I was just thinking the same thing, amend the resolution to state, and whereas the City Council is recommending a special meeting for the Planning Board to hear this, then it would be in the resolution that we can provide to the Planning Board.
Okay.
So are we tabled?
No, not at all. I just, we've discovered a mistake last week. We jumped on it as quick as possible. We just want to keep the ball moving and get this corrected as soon as possible.
By statute, they have to act within 45 days, but obviously we're trying to get them to act sooner than that.
Correct.
So if you'd like to add the provision that Michael just referenced, you just need a motion and a second and a vote to amend the resolution that's
motion
already been
moved
forward.
Motion to amend the resolution to ask the Planning Board to have a special meeting to address this as soon as possible.
And that be included in the resolution
that
you already
included in the resolution
have before you.
All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed?
So this doesn't go into the effect until the Planning Board?
Or 45 days. They don't have 45 days in the council.
Well, it won't go into effect. They are going to consider the proposal now and send their comments back to the council. And council has to move it forward by way of an ordinance to amend the CBD plan in order for this to fully become effective.
So all we're trying to do is speed up the
speed
process.
The process,
speed
exactly.
Up the 45-day wait.
To correct a mistake.
So the resolution has been amended, but now it needs to be adopted as amended.
Correct.
And Deputy Mayor Quinn and Councilmember Clayton made that motion and second with the amendment?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Resolution 2016-229, resolution authorizing an employment agreement between the City of Asbury Park and Deputy Police Chief Anthony Salerno. Can I have a motion, please?
Move it.
Second.
Comments or questions? Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Resolution 2016-230, resolution authorizing the City of Asbury Park to grant a license to permit encroachment into the area of the city right-of-way adjacent to the property located at 703 Asbury Avenue, Block 2602, Lot 10. Can I have a motion, please?
Move it.
Second.
Comments or questions?
Is Michelle still here?
No.
Are we right as far as inches? So.
I have the letter in front of me that the gentleman referenced, and it has the notation for inches.
Okay, so fine. Okay.
Quotation mark, if you will, as opposed to a single, which would indicate feet.
He wanted to make sure the measurements were right, Michelle. That's all.
Okay. No problem. Thank you.
Any further comments or questions? Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Resolution 2016-231, authorizing the award of contract regarding the operation of seasonal concessions to provide surf lessons to the public in designated area of the Asbury Park beachfront. May I have a motion, please?
Move it.
Second.
Comments or questions? Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Resolution 2016-232, resolution of the Mayor and City Council of the City of Asbury Park authorizing the execution of a supplemental confidential settlement agreement regarding James Famularo. Can I have a motion, please?
Move it.
Second.
Okay.
We're in tune tonight.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
We're on to ordinances. We have one ordinance for introduction, ordinance 2016-19, establishing a restricted parking space for use by handicapped persons at properties located at 1215 Springwood Avenue, designated block 1103, lot 48 in the City of Asbury Park, and amending and supplementing section 7-36 entitled Handicapped Parking, a Chapter 7 Traffic of the Revised General Ordinances of the City of Asbury Park, New Jersey. Can I have a motion to introduce this ordinance?
Move it. Second.
Any comments or questions? Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Public hearing is scheduled for this ordinance for May 25th, 2016. On to second reading. I have ordinance 2016-11, an ordinance amending and supplementing section 7-20 entitled One-Way Streets to Chapter 7, Traffic of the Code of the City of Asbury Park, New Jersey. I believe the council wishes to
motion to table.
Table this.
Second.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Ordinance 2016-15, ordinance of the City of Asbury Park authorizing the execution of a financial agreement with AEF2 Urban Renewal LLC and Savoy Urban Renewal and granting a tax exemption.
Motion to table.
Second.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Bond ordinance 2016-16, bond ordinance providing for various 2016 capital improvements and by and in the City of Asbury Park and the County of Monmouth, State of New Jersey, appropriating $1,750,000, therefore, and authorizing the issuance of $1,662,500 bonds or notes of the city to finance a part of the cost thereof. Public hearing was previously held on this ordinance, opened and closed on April 27, 2016. So at this time, I just need a motion to adopt ordinance 2016-16.
Move it.
Second.
Any further comments or questions? Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Ordinance 2016-17, bond ordinance providing for various 2016 roadway improvements by and in the City of Asbury Park and the County of Monmouth, State of New Jersey, appropriating $1,250,000, therefore, and authorizing the issuance of $1,187,500 bonds or notes of the city to finance a part of the cost thereof. Again, this also was had a public hearing opened and closed held on April 27, 2016. Therefore, I just need a motion to adopt ordinance 2016-17.
Move it.
Second.
Comments or questions? Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Got one more. Ordinance 2016-18. Refund. funding bond ordinance of the City of Asbury Park and the County of Monmouth, State of New Jersey, the city providing for, one, the refunding of certain outstanding qualified general improvement bonds of the city dated June 25th, 2009, and provide debt service savings, and two, authorizing the issuance of not to exceed $4,200,000 aggregate principal amount of general improvements refunding bonds of the city to effect such refunding and appropriating the proceeds therefore. This time, can I have a motion to open ordinance 2016-18 to the public?
Move it.
All in favor?
Aye. Michael or Fred, give a brief explanation, please. Yes.
It's refunding to save money.
Okay.
I mean, in 10 seconds or less. It's refunding to save money. The city's going to save like $40,000, Rita.
It's like refinancing your mortgage.
We're getting a lower rate on a bond issue. By doing this, we're saving $40,000. Would anybody like to be heard?
Motion to close the public portion.
Move it.
All in favor? Can I have a motion to adopt ordinance 2016-18?
Move it.
Second.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Motion to adjourn.
Adjourn.
Move it.
Second.